Good morning, good morning. I hate to even start because I hear and see such fellowship going on. And even myself, I was running around back there talking to folks. I was enjoying that. Don't get as much time to spend together in these days of the pandemic. So when we do, we certainly enjoy that fellowship and seeing one another. And spending that time together. So just a good morning to each and every one of you. Also want to welcome our folks who are watching and joining us online. And I know that there's so many folks who would love to be with us, but because of different circumstances and because of different health issues, they've decided and chosen not to join us in person. But the technology gives us that opportunity for folks to join us online. It's not ideal, but certainly better than nothing. So we've gathered together today, as we do each and every week, to not only spend time with one another, but to spend time with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we gather together to worship Him, to exalt Him. And we need to do that regularly, be reminded of that, because what's the temptation? The temptation is to exalt ourselves. But we don't want to do that. We're not worthy of worship and praise, although sometimes we think we are. But ultimately, God and His Son, Jesus Christ, is worthy, 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 worthy. And I want to remind us of that as we begin this time together. I just want to mention a few prayer requests. And why do we do this week after week? Because I know that during this time we're not as connected, but we want to make sure that prayer requests are mentioned. We also don't have the bulletin handout with all the list of prayer requests, so I just want to constantly remind us of some of these needs and also give you all an opportunity to share those requests. Because we lift our prayers up to a God who is mighty. And He's able to answer prayers. He's a God who still answers prayers even to today. And He loves to hear from us, His children. So let me just mention a few of those. Brother Roger had mentioned a request yesterday of a dear friend of his, Brother Roger Rice, and his wife, who they took to the hospital. And Roger mentioned this morning that Brenda is doing better and probably wasn't as serious as maybe they originally thought, but we still need to pray for her. And also Roger, who may need a procedure, having some health issues as well. So remember those folks. Also remember Wade Isaacs, who still needs surgery on his broken leg and still waiting for some documentation, things for that. So continue to remember him. Also, we want to praise God that Trista had a successful surgery. It's great to see you here with us this morning. She said she's feeling good this morning, so praise God for that. Let's give the Lord a hand in that regard. It's always great to... Sometimes we ask prayer requests and God comes through and we forget. But we need to be reminded of those times where God's always faithful. He's always working. But we want to be thanking Him as well. We want to remember the lost. Oftentimes we pray for the sick and those that are struggling, different needs, but we always need to remember those who are struggling and who are dead in their sins and trespasses. And so we want to remember the lost in our community, in our families, and surrounding our surrounding county as well, and even our country. Continue to remember our country. Remember Linda Hacker, who had another treatment this past week. This treatment affected her a little bit stronger than the last one. But she's still doing well and still very positive. We know she's going to continue to fight. Remember the colleges and schools that are starting back and speaking with some teachers this morning and staff. I know it's going to be an interesting year. So we want to remember our students, but also the staff, administration, and our teachers as well. It's good to see Brother Bill here with us. I know he's been having some health issues. We want to continue to remember him. He said he's still feeling very weak, so we need to just continue to lift him up in prayer. Are there any other prayer requests that I have not mentioned that you want to mention? This one, Miss Casey. Okay, this Casey Hayes just mentioned her sister who's going to the doctor this week to learn more about treatment. Okay, so we want to remember her. That's right. Rita's not here. She's sick today, and I know we've got others in our community that's sick. And even the Blauvelt family has been struggling some with some sickness as well. Anything else? Okay, that's right. We're going to continue to remember Brother Jeff Browning's mom and dad as well, especially. Okay, Sharon Allen's mentioned or asked us to remember her sister with the broken ribs. Doing a little bit better, but we want to keep remembering her. Okay. That's right. We want to remember Sharon. I know last week when she left, having some issues, some bleeding in her feet, but got that under control. So we praise God for that. And it's great to see you here with us today, Sharon. Okay. If there's nothing else, I'm going to ask Brother Ben Gilbert if he'll lift some of these requests up to our Heavenly Father. Amen. Thank you, Brother Ben. Just a few announcements. We received word from my good friend there in Pakistan, who has received the money that we gave towards the Bibles, and he just wanted to express his thanksgiving for that, knowing the great benefit that will be, and just getting Bibles in the hands of folks that desperately need it. And we know the power of the Word of God. And so he just wants to say thank you for that. Thank you all for giving and serving in that way. A business meeting at the end of this month. It'll be on the 30th. That'll be a Sunday. And we will do that immediately following the service, just as we always do. And we'll still kind of stay social distance, but just several things that we need to cover and look at and talk about. And also, we just want to give you all just an update as a church, what's going on and kind of the plans in the coming days. Also, we received word this past week that Leah McQueen is hosting a drive-by baby shower for her sister Savannah, who is pregnant with a baby boy. And so if you don't know that, we are overjoyed for that couple. And the Wilson couple, I always love seeing them because I always tell them we love to see more Wilsons around. Right, Brother Mitchell? I love to have Wilsons around. So on September the 26th, from 1 to 5 p.m., over here on Alfred Road, we're going to be doing a drive-by baby shower. They wanted us to mention this today, and Tetch has posted this on Facebook. September the 26th from 1 to 5 over here on Alfred Moore Road, where Linda Hockham used to live. I know she's moved down the road there, but where the McQueens live now. So I'll try to mention that again as we get closer to that. Birthdays and anniversaries. I know a couple anniversaries in here. Anniversary, Jeff and Nikki. How many? 20. Praise the Lord. Let's give the Lord a big hand on that one. And I think there's another anniversary in the back corner. Jody and Irma, how many years? 25. Let's give the Lord a hand on that one as well. Praise the Lord. Any other birthdays or anniversaries we want to make mention? Okay. Also, I want to make mention before we transition to a time of singing and song and worship in that way. We're continuing to take up offerings through mail-in, P.O. Box 64, but also we've got the offering plates in here and also online at amblebaptist.com for those that want to give that way. Now we're going to turn it over to Brother Greg, and he's going to lead us in a couple of songs.
When my way
Go ahead and just stand with me and let's stretch your legs out just a little bit. We're not going to stand for the reading of God's Word as we usually do, so just stand up and stretch it out a little bit, get a little blood flowing before we jump into God's Word. Maybe say hello to your neighbor if you haven't done so already, and stretch it out good, and when you're ready, you can go ahead and be seated. We're going to jump into God's Word here in a few moments. You know, some faith traditions actually stand up the whole service. So if you want to do that, that's fine with me as well. But today we're going to be starting a new teaching series. It's not going to be an extremely long one. Lord willing, it's going to be four different Sundays and should take us through the end of August. And it's a new series on the book of Ruth in the Old Testament. And so I've named this series From Tragedy to Triumph. From Tragedy to Triumph. And over the next three Sundays, four Sundays total, we're going to be looking at the book of Ruth. It's not a very long story, just four chapters, but I think it has a lot to say to us, especially in our current situation, the days that we live in here in the pandemic and even here hundreds of years later, after this story was first written and first lived out. It's not just a made-up story. I believe it's a true story. And so today's message, though, that the series title is From Tragedy to Triumph, but today's message is called To Moab and Back Again. To Moab and Back Again. And I want to just give just a little bit of introduction to the book of Ruth before we actually open God's Word and start reading and start journeying through this particular book. The book of Ruth is one of the two books in the Bible that is actually named for a woman. Of course, Ruth being the name, the other one being the book of Esther. But an interesting thing about both of those is they're neither one, not only named for women, but they're actually non-Hebrew names as well. Because Esther, who was actually a Jew, her Jewish name was Hadassah. So what's interesting about Ruth is not only is she one of the two books named after a woman in the Bible, but we see that she is, or she was, a Gentile. So this is pretty amazing. And then this is the only book in the Old Testament named after a non-Israelite. So we see up front that something's a little bit different about this story. And we're going to see that as we walk through it. But this is a love story. And I know some of the ladies that you might, okay, I'm excited about this. But I assure you, although it's a love story, it's not really a romance. It's a love story, not a romance. And Jotham and I, actually, this just came to me. We just recently introduced him to the Princess Bride that I grew up watching as a kid, and maybe some of you did as well. And it sounds like a really girly movie, I understand, but it's not. But there's a little boy in there, and what does he ask Jotham? He says, "Is this a kissing book?" Romance, I can't promise there'll be kissing, no kissing, but definitely a love story. It's named after Ruth, but really as we move through this book, we will see that it's actually not about Ruth. Ultimately, it's about God, because all the Bible is about the Lord God. But we're going to see another main character that really takes center stage from the beginning to the end, and that is Naomi. We're going to be talking a lot about Naomi today and even in the days to come. And we're going to take this week after week, we're going to take it chapter by chapter. And some of you, I hope, and my guess is most of you have already read this story. You know the end. You know that it's a happy ending. But even so, I'm still just going to try to take it bit by bit and reveal parts of the story as we move through. So here we go. Let's jump into this. Instead of reading all 22 verses of chapter 1, I just want to read a little bit, make some comments, and then when I finish the story, then I want to make some bigger picture comments and kind of some applications even for us here hundreds of years later. You can really thousands of years later after this story took place. So here we go. Ruth 1, verses 1. "Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled," and I'm going to stop right there because we need to see what's going on. When does this story take place? Well, the book of Ruth is sandwiched between the book of Judges and 1 Samuel. But we see right here from the beginning, this story took place sometime within the history and the story of the book of Judges. And if you've got your Bible open, you can actually go back to the very last verse in the book of Judges, and here's what's going on in the time of Judges. The very last verse says this: "In those days there was no king in Israel. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes." And if everybody's doing what's right in their own eyes, I assure you it's probably not very good. Because if they're doing what's right in their own sinful eyes, their own human flesh, they're making a lot of decisions that they shouldn't do, that have been basically unfaithful to God. And when you read through the book of Judges, you're going to see a cycle that happens over and over. The people of God, they rebel against Him. They do things their own way. They worship other gods. God sends a foreign group to come in and oppress them. And what do the people of Israel do? They cry out to God, "God, please help us from this foreign oppression." And what does God do? God has mercy on the people when they repent and when they call out to Him for help. And God sends in a sense, a human savior in the form of a judge to come in and conquer all the bad guys, and then there's peace again. But if you read the book of Judges, you know what happens after that. The people rebel again. They worship other gods, which God sees as idolatry and views as adultery. God sends a neighboring warring nation. They're oppressed. They call out for help. God sends a judge. You see the cycle over and over. So somewhere in one of those cycles, at some point there, we see that the book and the story of Ruth takes place. Let's keep going here in verse 1. Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land. And a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, and that's to distinguish between another Bethlehem, he went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. Verse 2, and the name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi, and the name of his two sons Mahlon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem, Judah. And they came into the country of Moab and continued there. So the story begins in the town of Bethlehem, and I believe this is the same Bethlehem that our Savior Jesus Christ was born hundreds of years later. We see that it happens in Bethlehem, and the name of Bethlehem means house of bread. But what's the problem? There was a famine, and therefore there is no bread in Bethlehem. And so this Jewish Israelite, Elimelech, what does he do? He decides to take his family from the promised land and to take them to a place called Moab. And he does that. So what does he do? He takes the people from the land of promise and he takes them to the land of compromise. We're going to see why I say that in just a few moments. Because for us, when we first read this story, we're like, well, that's not a big deal. That's probably a good decision. There's no food in Bethlehem. Let's move to Moab. Maybe they've got food there. Maybe there's opportunity there. But to original Jewish audience and to a group of Israelites, if they were reading this story from the very beginning, they would say, oh, no, he didn't. Right? That's something we would say. Oh, no, they didn't. They would have realized the problem with this from the very beginning. It's not a big deal for us, but to leave the land of promise, the place in which the Israelites, all the Old Testament, pretty much up to this point, had been trying to get to the land of promise, to then uproot your family and move to Moab, would have been unthinkable. And why would it have been unthinkable? Because you need to realize a few things about Moab. The Israelites didn't like the Moabites. And they had good reason. Think about the origins of the people of Moab. You can read this back in Genesis 19. We see that Moab, the lead man who led to the Moabites, how was he conceived? He was conceived through an incestuous relationship between Lot and one of his daughters. You can read about that. So Moab began through an incestuous relationship between Lot and one of his daughters. And then when Israel finally left Egypt and they're making their way to the promised land, the Israelites wanted to move through Moab. But the Moabites said, no, you can't come through here. And so they were constantly antagonizing them. And not only would they not let them move through, but we see also later on that the Moabite women come out and they try to seduce the Israelites. And because of all those reasons and others that I'm not going to get into, when Moses writes Deuteronomy chapter 23, and it's a part of the law of God, and God gives this as well, we see that a Moabite was not allowed to even enter into the assembly of God. That's how much animosity, how much tension was there. They couldn't even enter into the assembly of the Lord. And one final thing is when you read Judges chapter 3, you see that the king of Moab, this king Eglon, he had recently oppressed the people of God. And maybe this story was sometime just after that. We're not exactly about the date. So for Elimelech to take his family and move from the promised land to the place and to the country of compromise to Moab would have been a huge mistake in the eyes of all the Israelites. You know, we think about, and you get the New Testament, you see the tension between Samaritans and Israelites the same way, the same negative perspective. For him to move to Moab was unthinkable. But then the unimaginable happens once they get to Moab. Look in verse 3. And Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died. And we don't know, was this God's judgment for doing this? He doesn't say, so we shouldn't make assumptions here. But what we do know is that Naomi was left and her two sons. And they took them wives of the women of Moab, The name of the one, Orpah, the name of the other, Ruth. And they dwelled there about 10 years. And then the unimaginable and the unthinkable happens again. And Mahlon and Chilion died also, both of them. And the woman was left of her two sons and her husband. So let me sum up what's going on here. Elimelech took his family. They went to Moab, seeking probably food. And who knows, we don't know exactly the motivation behind that. But when he gets there, he ends up dying. And Naomi's left with her two sons. Well, her two sons marry two Moabites, Orpah and Ruth. And then after 10 years of marriage, though her two sons pass away. So it's one thing. Some of you in here, you've lost a spouse. I mean, it's hard enough to deal with losing a spouse. But then on top of that, to lose both of your sons. I mean, you start to see the situation that she's in here. And in those days, this would have been a big deal, because without sons and without children and with her without a husband, she couldn't have any kids or grandkids. And the name, her name could not be passed on. Her family was, in fact, going to die. And I want to show you, and I want to just read a quote here to help you understand the situation. It says, "And this is the curse of all curses. In the ancient Near East, particularly in Israel, there was no greater tragedy," listen to this, "no greater tragedy than for a family to cease to exist." And this sets up the ultimate problem of the book. And what is that? Because Naomi's family now teeters on extinction. And this is a big deal. For us, it's like, okay, it's we don't like that idea. But for a Jew, this was huge. And so to emphasize this, look back in verse 5. It doesn't even use Naomi's name. It says in verse 5, the second half, it says, "The woman was left of her two sons and her husband." See, she's now virtually lost her identity. She's an aged widow with two barren daughter-in-laws from Moab. Now listen to this. She has no hope, no security, no home, no future, nothing. And so we've got to feel the weight of this. Realize what's... So it's not just that she lost her husband and her sons. It's far weightier than just that. But that leads to verse 6. "Then she arose," this is Naomi, "with her daughters-in-law, that she might return from the country of Moab. For she had heard in the country of Moab how that the Lord had visited his people in giving them bread." This is the first mention of the Lord in the story. She had heard that God had visited his people. Now, we don't know why the famine was there in the first place. Is it because of the people's disobedience? Is it because of the people's rebellion? We don't know that. We're not told that. But what she does hear from Moab is that the Lord had come to help his people. And let me tell you this, brothers and sisters, that is what the Lord always does. He comes to help his people. Even when we think he's absent, when we think he's silent, when we wonder where is he at, he is going to help his people. We can hold on to that promise in our lives. We're going to see that in this story. So let's continue here in verse 7. "Wherefore she went forth out of the place where she was, and her two daughters-in-law with her. And they went on the way to return into the land of Judah. And Naomi said unto her two daughters-in-law, Go, return each to her mother's house. The Lord deal kindly with you, as ye have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant you that ye may find rest, each of you in the house of her husband. Then she kissed them, and they lifted up their voice and wept." So Naomi, she starts to head back to Israel. She's heard the Lord has come to help them, and he's present with his people there. And so as they start to go back, what does she do? She tells her daughters-in-laws that she stops along the way. And I just get this image of them on the road, the dust all around them, and it's hot. And she tells them, she says, "Hey, you guys, you girls, you need to go back to your home. You need to go back to your land." And when she does this, they embrace, and they weep, and they're just, I can just see them kind of hugging here, the three of them here in the middle of the road on the way back. But it doesn't stop there, because at first they resist. She tells them, "Go back home, go." But at first they resist. And they say, no, no, we're not going to. They say, surely, verse 10, surely we will return with you and to your people. Verse 11, Naomi said, turn again, my daughters. Why will ye go with me? Are there yet any more sons in my womb, and that they may be your husbands? Turn again, my daughters, go your way. For I am too old to have an husband. If I should say, I have hope, if I should have an husband also tonight, and should also bear sons, would ye tarry for them till they were gone or grown? Would ye stay for them from having husbands? Nay, my daughters, for it grieveth me much for your sakes that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me. So what's she saying here? Let me just sum this up. Naomi's telling her daughters-in-law who said, no, we'll go with you. She says, no. She says, I don't have any more kids in my womb. I'm not married. I'm old. The chance of me getting married is not very likely. And even if I do get married, can I still have a child? And if I have a child, would you wait until that child grows up to marry him? And what's the chance that she'd have a son? She might have a daughter. And so she's saying, no, don't do this. Go back home. And when I first read this, and when I was younger, I thought, wow, this is, Naomi's being pretty harsh with them right here. But as I've read it this past week and studied and thought about it, this is very loving and compassionate. She's trying to be loving and compassionate to them because she knows that if they go with her, they will suffer the same fate as she has, as she's going to experience. And so what she wanted to do, she said, go home. Go to your homes. Get married. Have children. Have a life. Because if you go with me, you're not going to have a life. In other words, that's what she's saying. Go home. Do that. And verse 14, and they lifted up their voices, and here they are on the road. I just see them in the road, and the dust all around them, and they're weeping and crying again, and they're embracing. And it says, and Orpah kissed her mother-in-law. Oop, I'm sorry, Jophamite. There's a kiss right there, but this is a familiar. It's a family kiss here. It says, Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clave unto her. And when it says Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, I think she kissed her goodbye. She kissed her goodbye, and she returned. But it says right here, and this is so important, don't miss what it says here, Ruth clave unto Naomi. This is the same word that God uses in Genesis chapter 2 to describe husbands and wives. It says, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall become one flesh. It's the same language here. Now don't miss this. It's not saying that somehow Naomi and Ruth are now married. No. But you see here the commitment. She is clinging to her. She is committed to her. She's saying, hey, I'm with you no matter what happens, no matter how bad it gets. I am with you. I am sticking by your side. And now, is that not a word for marriage? You can see what that means when we think about it in marriage, right? When we get married to someone, what are we saying? We're saying, hey, I love you. I'm sticking with you. I'm committed to you no matter how bad it gets, for better or worse. Amen? I am sticking by your side. And so this is what Ruth is saying. She was committed to her. And we see a contrast here between Ruth and Orpah, because Orpah left Naomi and she went back. Now, I know Naomi was encouraging her in that, but we see an example of unbelief through Orpah here, because to go back home was to go back to her gods. To go with Naomi was to follow the one true living God. And so we see a resistance of that on her part. But at the same time, we sympathize with Orpah. You know, we can kind of relate to her as well. But look what it says here in verse 15. And she said, this is Naomi speaking to Ruth, behold, thy sister-in-law is gone back unto her people and unto her gods. Return thou after thy sister-in-law. She tries to dissuade her again. She says, go, go. But here's what Ruth says, and this is the most famous passage and verse really we see in all the books. So listen here very closely. And Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee or to return from following after thee, for whither thou goest, I will go. And where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God, my God. Where thou diest, I will die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me and more also, if aught but death part thee and me. Ruth makes this oath, this public commitment, this public pledge of commitment to Naomi here on the road. And this is a famous statement. We hear this in songs. Chris Tomlin's got a famous song called I Will Follow. It goes something like, where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I'll follow. And I cut that. Maybe some of you know that song. I got kind of that tune in my mind now. But this is often spoken at weddings. Maybe you had it at your own wedding. And it's this commitment saying, hey, wherever you go, I'm going with you. Wherever you stay, wherever you dwell, I'm going to dwell with you. But the irony of that, and that's nothing wrong with that because I love it. It's a strong message of commitment. But notice that this is actually spoken between daughter-in-law and mother-in-law. How many times have you heard a word of commitment like that spoken to in-laws at a wedding, right? Usually it's kind of like, ooh, I hope they don't interfere with our lives. But it's this strong commitment that we see there. And verse 18, when it says, when Naomi saw that Ruth was steadfastly minded, when she was determined to go with her, then she left speaking unto her. I think Naomi's almost speechless here. She realizes Ruth is not going to budge. She was firm in her resolve. She was firm in her commitment. And they just travel on, I think, without even speaking. She leaves us speaking to Ruth. And they travel on quietly, on towards Bethlehem. Verse 19, we're going to see what happens when they get to Bethlehem. So they two went until they came to Bethlehem. And it came to pass when they were come to Bethlehem, that all the city was moved about them. In essence, they caused quite the stir when they came to Bethlehem, and I believe all the people were talking about their arrival. And then they asked this question, the people who'd been looking and watching, and you think Anvil's a small town. Bethlehem was really a small town. Everybody, I'm sure everybody knew everybody, and they would talk and all this. They asked this question. They said, is this Naomi? You know, Naomi that you grew up down the road over here in this house. Is this Naomi? And she said unto them, verse 20, call me not Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty hath dealt very bitterly with me. Now, notice the scene here. Naomi left. She was a younger woman. She'd been married. And they left out. She comes back. She has no husband. She has no sons, and she only returns, and I'm sure hardly any possessions, and she returns with a Moabite daughter-in-law. And again, this is scandalous, and it's no wonder that they caused quite a stir when she returned. And think about this also, not only just the loss, but years of deprivation. And also the grief of losing her husband and her two sons, I think it had taken a physical toll on Naomi. So much so that the people looked at her and said, that can't be the same Naomi that we once knew. Is that truly her? Think about all that had happened in her life. She didn't even look like the same person. She had struggled and experienced so much difficulty and challenge and so many challenges. And what's interesting is the name Naomi actually means pleasant, or the pleasant one. So this woman who had left Bethlehem as Naomi, the pleasant one, a robust woman in her prime, she returns as a haggard, destitute old woman. And we've got to feel the weight of this. And what had happened in her life, But then the experience when she comes back, and so she says, hey, don't even call me Naomi. Don't call me the pleasant one. Call me Mara, because Mara means bitterness. And years of suffering and struggle, I think, had made her bitter. Maybe bitter towards people, but I think bitter towards God. Look what she says in verse 21. It starts to kind of overflow into her speech as well. She says, I went out full. And the Lord had brought me back home again empty. Why then call ye me Naomi, seeing the Lord hath testified against me, and the Almighty hath afflicted me. We see in her words, here's what I noticed about her words, and I want you to see this too. She had a strong sense of God's sovereignty in her life. She knew that all that had happened to her was through the hand of God. And I think there's a sense of that being true, is that God is sovereignly in control of everything. But what we don't see in her words here is a sense of God's love and mercy and compassion and goodness. His loving kindness and His faithfulness that we so often see through all of Scripture, it's missing here, because we cannot separate God's sovereignty from His character, from His love and His compassion and His goodness and who He is. But at the same time, we read this and we say, man, I can't hardly blame her. You know, I can see, if you really try to put yourself in her shoes, you see, I can see why she might be bitter. All that had gone on in her life, all that had happened to her. I mean, she'd moved away from the promised land with her husband. And most of the time in those days, she probably wouldn't have had much of a say. It would have been the husband that said, let's go. And so she moved. She lost her husband, her two sons, left all alone by one daughter-in-law, and then still here with one daughter-in-law, a Moabitess. No family other than that. Reputation gone. Her honor gone, nothing but shame, homeless, without money, without food. And we see here she is, and she's bitter. And there's no indication through all this and through the book of Ruth here, there's no indication of sin, anything that she committed, any sin that she committed in this first chapter, that she could say, oh, God has punished me because of this. So we see, just like in the story of Job, a picture of seemingly unwarranted, mysterious suffering that evokes the question, why? Why me? Why is this happening? Maybe you've experienced this in your life. Maybe you've asked the same question. Why me, God? Where were you? Where are you, God? And sometimes we ask the same question. God, are you absent? Or maybe we even get bitter, or we get angry at God for the things that happen in our life, because we think that He is absent or that He's not good, but we know that that is not true. We must believe and realize that God is always working good in our situation. Always. Even when we think that He's not there, that He's absent, that He's angry at us, we need to realize that He is working good. Even if He's bringing about good that we may not want. He doesn't always bring about the things that we want, but we trust and know that He is good and He's working to bring about good. There's always hope in our situation. And that leads us to the last verse. A word of hope in this last verse. It says, so Naomi returned, and Ruth the Moabitess. Notice how she's even referred to here. It's not just Ruth, the daughter-in-law, but it's Ruth, the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law, with her, which returned out of the country of Moab. And they came to Bethlehem in the beginning of the barley harvest. Right there, that last phrase. And if you read the story, you know what we're talking about. But that last phrase right there is a message of hope as we transition to chapter 2. We're going to do that next week. But there's a message of hope there. Why is that? Because that verse sets up what's going to be happening in the coming days. And it's going to reveal God's plan and how He had planned to work good in the life of Naomi. We're going to see that Naomi's story moves from tragedy to triumph. And there's going to be a happy ending. Her story moves from tragedy to triumph. And why is that? Because God is at work all throughout her story. Even those times when she didn't think He was, or thought she was working to somehow bring evil towards her, God was always working to bring about good, just as He's always working to bring good in our stories. You see, in the moments of difficulty and trial, persecution, suffering, despair, when God seems so distant, when God seems so far away, He may actually be setting the stage for the greatest demonstration of his faithfulness to you. Did you hear that? When in our moments of deepest, darkest despair, we need to realize that God may be working to set up and to show and reveal his faithfulness to you and to me. See, all throughout history, we see that God ordains sorrowful tragedy to set the stage for surprising triumph. I want to read that again. I want to say that again. God so often ordains sorrowful tragedy to set the stage for surprising triumph. And that's why I've named this series what I have. And you see, this is the case for Jesus Christ and the cross. Because why is that? Because God took the darkest day in history, the day that his son Jesus Christ was nailed to that old rugged cross with a crown of thorns on his head, nails in his hands, nails in his feet, whipped and beaten on that same day, betrayed by a close friend. God took the darkest day in history and he used it to turn into the brightest day in history. Because in the darkest day, and literally and figuratively, because we know darkness came upon the area there and when Jesus was on the cross, but it led to the greatest day of triumph, the empty tomb. You see that? And how often I've wondered, the disciples on that day when they're scattered in the garden the night before, and maybe they're in the distance, they see Jesus on the cross, and they think, well, this is dark. We thought this was going to be, thought Jesus was the one. And that moment of heartache, and they see that, and they experience that tragedy and that despair. They did not know that Sunday was coming. And I think that's the same way with us. We need to realize that no matter what we're going through, the difficulty that God is working, sovereignly working to bring about good, and we don't know what is coming on down the road. We don't always know what God is up to. But through Jesus' death, that darkest day on the cross, he brought about salvation for all those who would believe, that we can be reconciled to God, that our sins can be forgiven by grace through faith in his son, Jesus Christ. And that gives us great hope when we realize, and if you're listening today, or maybe you're here today and you've not made that decision to follow Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I beg you to do that today. To not lay your head down on your pillow tonight without making things right with God. Because God turned the darkest day into the brightest day. You see, in difficult times, as followers of Jesus Christ, in difficult times, no matter what's going on, you know what we need to do? We need to be like Ruth to Naomi, and we need to cling to Jesus Christ. Now, I mentioned that in the context of marriage. But this is the same when it comes to Jesus Christ. In those times of difficulty, those times of despair, we cling to Jesus Christ. And we say, I'm committed to you, Jesus. Where you go, I go. Where you lead, I will follow. And we have that resolve. We must cling to Jesus Christ. And we do this trusting. Trusting that he is sovereignly working to bring good in our situation, to bring our joy, and ultimately to glorify his name. I want to read that last phrase one more time. They came to Bethlehem in the beginning of the barley harvest. There's great hope in that verse as it leads to and it reveals to us God's plan for Naomi and God's plan for Ruth. And we're going to see God's redemptive plan for all of mankind through this family because he was working good. And we can trust that, we can believe that, and therefore we must cling to Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, right now, we want to thank you that you're a God who's always at work. And you're always working to bring good because you're a good God. You're a God full of love and compassion and mercy. In those difficult times, God, when we ask the question, why? I pray that we would look back to this story here and the beginning of this story of Naomi, and we would see that you're always at work, God. You're not distant. You're not angry at us. You love us. We are your children. We'd be reminded that. We'd be encouraged by that, God. And as we are reminded of that, God, I pray that we would cling to you, hold on to you, not let you go, Father. It's so easy to get distracted and to put our faith and hope in other things, God. But our hope truly is in Jesus Christ. and that we would cling to you, God. And if there's anyone here this morning that does know your Son Jesus is Lord and Savior, God, I pray that they would step out in faith and they would just cling to you, that you would be the only hope that they have. They would repent of their sins and turn to you, God. That's my hope. That's my prayer. We'd be encouraged by this story this morning as your people. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Amen. We're going to have a song of invitation right now. I know it's something that we've done on and off the past few weeks. But we're going to get a song of invitation going. And here's what I want you to do. I want you just to reflect on your relationship with Jesus Christ right now. If you're a follower of Jesus, and ask this question. Ask yourself this question. Am I clinging to Jesus Christ right now in my life? And if not, repent of that and say, and just go to Christ. Commit yourself to Him. And then if you're here this morning, or maybe you're listening online, you've not put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, I pray that you would do that this morning. Repent, turn from your sins, turn from making and trying to do things your own way, like Elimelech, right? We all have Elimelech in each and every one of us. Turning from the promises of God, turning, trying to do things our own way, but we want to repent of that and turn to follow Jesus Christ. As David cues the music now and Brother Greg singing, just reflect on this. Go to the Father.
Just as I am with thy blood, but that thy blood was shed for me.
Are you clinging to Christ this morning? Are you going your separate way? Running away like Orpah. Don't run. Cling, cleave to Christ. Are you mad at Christ today? Are you mad at God? Take that to Him. Are you bitter? Confess that to Him. Ask Him to show you His love and His goodness and His mercy this morning. Be honest with Him. Leave here today without making things right with Him, your relationship with Him. Today, clinging to Christ, and may we do that all day, every day, every moment. It's not easy following Christ, but He says, I'll be right there with you, and we can cling to Him because He's always with us. And what a great encouragement that is. As always, I'll be here afterwards if you need prayer, if you need someone to talk about or talk to. I'll be around. And anybody online, I always make myself accessible to you as well. As we close out today, I'm going to ask Brother Jason Vaughn if he'll close us in a word of prayer. Now go and be the church. You're dismissed.